Now, since we are concerned with the amounts of loans and deposits in the system, let's focus on these two parameters and their constraints. We need to understand the relationship between loans, deposits, and reserves and their constraints, since in our discussion on central banks, these are the three areas central banks are concerned with. These are the three core areas central banks are concerned with when it comes to their monetary policy. So as we've mentioned, banks can increase their loan amounts by either increasing their deposits or lowering their reserves. Now let's look at the pros and cons of both. Increasing deposits. Banks borrow to lend and earn a spread between their lending rates and borrowing rates, as we have seen. The more they borrow, the more they can lend. Banks can increase deposits by making them more attractive. That is, increasing their deposit rates, explicit deposit rate, or providing extra free facilities, which is basically increasing implicit rates. This makes deposits more expensive and reduces the spreads that banks earn. Banks cannot simultaneously increase their lending rates as customers will migrate to other banks. Now, bad loans will also increase as customers with good credit ratings will source cheaper loans elsewhere and the bad customers will come to our bank. Therefore, increasing deposits without squeezing margins is not easy. Now let's look at reducing reserves. Currently, the Bank of Metrocity has 5 million in reserves earning a zero interest rate. If the Bank of Metrocity reduces its reserves at the Reserve Bank of Metrocity to 4 million, it can increase its loan amount by $1 million. This translates to 13.25 into $1 million or $132,500 in revenue, improving the return on equity to 17.45%. So this is great. We can reduce the bank's reserves to increase the ROE substantially. Let's take an extreme case where we can reduce the bank reserves to zero and boost the ROE substantially. So that's not really possible. The Reserve Bank of Metrocity places a legal reserve requirement on all banks in Metrocity at 10% of checking deposits and 0% of regular deposits. Therefore, the required reserves of Metro Bank can fall to 10% of 20 million, making that $2 million. So this is a regulatory requirement by the Reserve Bank of Metrocity, which has to be complied with. So we have a reserve of $5 million, which can be reduced to $2 million. And the rest can be utilized to improving profits. Most central banks around the world require banks to hold reserves as part of their liquidity management. Many central banks require that the banks hold reserves in two forms. One of them is in cash, called the cash reserves at the central bank, which is at a specific ratio of net deposits, and it's also called the cash reserve ratio or CRR. The other form is near cash, but not as liquid as cash, in the form of government securities, and the ratio is called the statutory reserve ratio or the SLR. So we will go deeper into this later, but for now, let's understand that besides statutory requirements, there are also more practical reasons for banks holding reserves. So we saw the first way of improving our return on equity is to increase deposits. However, there are many constraints to increasing deposits. So let's look at the second way of increasing our return on equity, which is through reserves.